Morning class slash afternoon. We're going to start on problem number two today. Number two says a snowstorm occurs in Chicago. The graph below shows the constant rate of change of the snow level on a city street. Which of the following is a true statement about the situation? Okay. So here letter A says the snow is falling at a rate of 1 inch every 2 hours. So if I look here, here's my inches and here's my hours. So if I was at 1 inch every 2 hours, that would be right here at 2, 1. As you can see, this line does not go through that. And I'm going to zoom in a little bit so you can see a little better. Okay, let's take a look at letter B. The snow is falling at a rate of 10 inches every hour. So that means in 1 hour, every hour, we would have 10 inches. This is where 10 is. Okay, and so obviously that's not happening, right? Whenever you read these answer choices, you should plot them on the graph and see, do they go through the line? If they don't go through the line, then they're simply not happening. Here it says the snow is falling at a rate of 2 inches every hour. So that means at 1 hour, we would have 2 inches, which that looks like that's happening. That means at 2 hours, we would have 4 inches. And 3 hours, we would have 6 inches, because 2 inches every hour. And D says the snow is falling at a rate of 0.5 inches every hour. Well, that would be 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3. Okay, and that's obviously not happening because it's obviously doing 2 inches every hour. Okay, this graph is scaled by 2s, so 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, and so on, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30. Okay? I think problems 2A and 2B you should be able to do on your own. So I'm going to let you do those in just a little bit. We're going to go ahead and move on from those problems. We're going to go to number 3. Okay, and number 3, remember M is my slope and B is my y-intercept. And it says, look at the graph below. Which of the following represents the slope and y-intercept of the line? Okay. Well, I like to start out by doing my y-intercept. My y-intercept is where my line crosses the y-axis, and that happens right here at negative 4. So B should be negative 4. So A looks good. B looks good. We can cross C out because that's positive 4. Okay. And D looks good. Okay. Now I need to determine my slope. Well, it looks like I've got negative 2/3. 3/2 and 2/3. Well, here my slope is positive. If I try to make that n for negative, notice how it makes a backwards n. So I know my slope is positive, so I can cross out a. So now I've got to determine, is my slope 3/2 or is it 2/3? Okay, and we can do this by doing rise over run. Okay, and so I'm going to pick a point. I can start here, and then I can look for another point. Looks like there's another point right here. And it looks like there's another point right here. And right here. And I'm simply just going to do rise over run. So I'm going to rise 1, 2. 1, 2. And I'm going to run 1, 2, 3. Rise 2, run 3. Rise 2, run 3. Every single time. So it looks like my slope is 2/3. So D is my answer. Okay. Remember that your formula is y equals mx plus b. Okay, so you can actually make these answer choices into equations. For example, here, y equals m, which is 2/3. Okay, m, which is 2/3. X plus b, which is negative 4. Okay, so if I come in my calculator, I can go to the y equals 2 divided by 3x plus negative 4. I can hit the graph, and I should see a graph that looks just like this. Okay, another way you can validate is, you know, you have some points here, so 0, negative 4, and 3, negative 2, and 6, comma 0, and looks like we have 9, comma 2. Okay, well, let's go to the table and see if those points are there. Oh, there's 0, negative 4, and 3, negative 2, and 6, comma 0, and 9, comma 2. Okay, and so that's another great way you can validate that you have the right answer and the right equation. Okay? And for 3a and 3b, okay, notice how they say slope and y-intercept, and then you have m and b again. Okay, and so you should be able to do these on your own now. Once again, a great trick to do is to draw an n, so you know both of these have negative slopes. Okay, and so that can help you eliminate some answers, and I'm going to let you do those on your own. All right, 3C I do want to do together because I want to show you a couple different strategies. Okay, so you already know the strategy of M and B. Okay, in this case, though, they don't give you a graph. They give you a table. Okay, and so in this case, what you can do is you can turn these into equations. There's two options here. You can turn these into equations. So I can say y equals 24x plus 9. I can say y equals 24x plus 0. I can say y equals 9x plus 24. I can say y equals 0x plus 24. Okay, all I did was put m where m goes and b where b goes. Okay, in my equation, y equals mx plus b. Okay? And so I can literally type each of these in individually and see which table matches. Okay, so for example, number one is 24x plus 9. So I can look and see, is it 1, 33? Yes, it is. Is it 2, 57? Yes, it is. Is it 3, 81? Yes, it is. Is it 4, 105? Okay, so we found that A is our answer. Okay, that was lucky. It was the first one. Right, if I tried B, for example, y equals 24x plus 0. You don't have to type the 0. You can just write 24x. Okay, notice how 133 doesn't happen. Okay, the numbers don't match. Okay. And they wouldn't match for any of these because A was our correct answer. The other way to do this is to go stat, enter for edit. Okay. And we're going to name this one L1. Okay, and usually they should be named for you, L1 and L2. If they're not, though, you can name them, and you just go alpha, and then you look for the green L, which is here, and then this would be 2. Okay, and then what you can do is you can enter in your X values in L1, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and you just hit 1, enter, 2, enter, 3, enter, 4, enter, and then I can go 33, enter, 57, enter, 81, enter, 105, enter. Okay, so I've got these in the graph. Okay, then I can go stat, calc, the number 4 option, which is linear regression. And then I can hit enter there, and then I can go down to calculate. And on this one, it's not letting me do it because it's archived. But on your calculator, you should be able to do it. So if this happens to you, on your calculator, okay, you need to make sure you ask your test administrator for a different one, okay? Because notice how when I went to, so I'm going to hit quit here, okay? Now I'm going to actually quit out and I'm going to clear it and we're going to look at this again, okay? So when I hit stat edit, notice how they're not named, okay? If that happens to you, it's going to give you that archive message. That just means that the calculator for some reason hasn't been programmed right, because if you notice here on this calculator, if I go stat edit, see how L1, L2, and L3 are already named for me? So it'll work if I do it on here. So 1, enter, 2, enter, 3, enter, 4, enter. Those are my X values. Okay, and then I'm going to do my Y values. 33, 57, 81, 105. Okay, then I'm going to go back to stat. I'm going to scroll over to calc. I'm going to go down to 4. And then I'm going to scroll down to calculate, okay, and see how it gives me A is 24 and B is 9. Well, 24 and 9. Okay, so that's another strategy you can use with a table is you can do the stat edit function. Once again, I'll do it again, stat edit, type in your X values into L1, your Y values into L2, then you're going to go back to stat again, you're going to go right, to calc. You're going to go down to number 4, linear regression, linreg. You hit enter. Then you're going to scroll down to calculate, and it will calculate it for you. Okay? Once again, if you get a calculator that's like this and it's unarchived, ask for a different calculator. Okay? All right, 3D, this one's asking you for the y-intercept of the function. Okay, and it says, so the table below contains 2 points of a linear function. What is the y-intercept of the graph of the linear function? Okay, so this one's kind of tough because it doesn't give you a graph, right? And it doesn't give you an equation. Okay, it just asks you, what is the y-intercept? Okay, a couple ways you can do this. I would personally use the graph paper. So, for example, I would turn back here to the front, right, and I would rip out my graph paper and I would use it. Okay, now I'm just going to turn back so I can see the points here. So it gives me negative 5, negative 4, and 3, 8. Okay, so I'm going to turn to my graph paper. I'm just going to make a little graph here. I'm just going to kind of box it out. So if I want room to make more graphs, I can. Okay, and so here's going to be my middle. There's my y-axis and my x-axis. This is my y-axis. This is my x-axis. So I had, I think it was negative 5, negative 4. Let me just double check. Negative 5, negative 4, and 3, 8. So negative 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3. So negative 5, negative 4, and then it was 3, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so I went off my graph there a little bit. Let me just double check. Yep, okay, we're good to go. All right, and now I'm going to do rise over run. So I'm going to do rise over run. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, I had to go 1 over because I went 1 over. Okay, so this was up 12. So rise 12. And then I'm going to run 1 and just stay with the lines when you do this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I rose 12 and I ran 8. So my calculator, 12 divided by 8, gives me 1.5. Okay? And if I go math, enter, enter, that gives me 3 over 2. So guess what? Now I can rise 3 and run 2. Rise 3, run 2. Because the same thing as rising 12 and running 8. Rise 3, run 2. Rise 3, run 2. Rise 3, run 2. Rise 3, run 2. Okay, and that helps me make my straight line. All right, but now I need my y-intercept, and it looks like it's right about here, okay, where my line crosses the y-axis. So that looks like it's at 0, let's see, 1, 2. Looks like it's about 3.5. Let's see if that's one of our answer choices. It certainly is. Okay, and so that's the way I think I would do it. That's the way I like to do it, is just graph it, okay, and then do rise over run. Okay, this one's the same idea, except you're trying to find the slope, so you can once again graph it, or you can also do delta y over delta x. Either strategy would work. I'll let you do that one on your own, and we are going to move to number 5. Number 5, it says the table show below shows the temperature of the water in a lake during 1 week in December. Okay, you have a table here and you have equations. So, once again, the best strategy here, this is a give me question, type in the equations. So, y equals 0.5x plus 72. Does the table match? So, 172.5? No, that's 71.5. So, immediately, you know, A is not right. 0.5x plus 71. See if that one works. 171.5. That looks good. 271. Uh-oh. Nope, that one doesn't match. That's 272. Okay, let's look at C. Y equals negative 0.5x plus 72. 171.5, good. 271, good. 370.5, 470, 569.5. Looks like letter C matches. That's how easy these are, guys. All you gotta do is look in the calculator, see if they match. Okay, same thing here. This time you don't have a table, but you do have points. Nothing different. Okay, you're just literally typing the equation into the calculator. 3 divided by 4x plus 5. Do I have 2, negative 2, 6.5? Nope. Do I have 9, negative 1.75? Nope. Back to the y equals. How about negative 3 fourths x minus 5? Okay, do I have negative 2, 6.5? Nope. How about 3 fourths x minus 5? Negative 2, nope. That one didn't work. Let's try, oops, I did minus 55. See, and this is, you got to make sure you type it in correctly. So this is minus 5, so I need to delete this. And now I can go back and see if that's right. See? And that would have been, well, no, that's not right. Negative 2, negative 6.5. So it's got to be D. Let's take a look. Negative 3 divided by 4x plus 5. Negative 2, 6.5. And it should be 9, negative 1.75. Which it is. Sometimes you get lucky. You get in on the first one. Other times you have to go through all of them. Okay, but at the end of the day, it really doesn't take that long. You're literally just typing your answer choices into y equals and making sure that they match up. Okay? I'll let you do 5b on your own. 5b is a great one because you can type in the equation of the calculator and look at the graph. Okay? And you can also validate that the points match in the calculator because they give you 2 points right here. Okay? Number 6 says solve the equation shown below. Okay? Once again, this is very easy. Line down the middle. Okay, y1, y2. Okay, so I'm going to go 1 divided by 2x plus 6, and 2 divided by 3x plus 5. Second graph. Okay, so I'm going to look and see where y1 and y2 are the same. The great news is here I have my answer choices ready for me, so I can scroll right to them. So 9, y1 and y2 are not the same. 6, y1 and y2 are the same. 1, y1 and y2 are not the same, where x is 1. And negative 6, see, not the same. But see, at 6, they are the same. X equals 6. Very simple. No reason you should miss these problems here. Okay, once again, 6a, we can go... y1 and y2. Okay. 6b, y1 and y2. 6b, y1 and y2. Okay. I want to do 6b real quick because I want to show you the strategy and make sure that you're not afraid of decimals. So 0.75x minus 1.2, 0.5x minus 0.575. Okay. Now notice how your x column you have all integers, right? You don't have decimals. Okay. So what you can do is second window. Okay. Once again, that's second window. Go to the table start. Type in the answer choices. Negative 2.5. Second graph. It'll take you right to it. Are y1 and y2 the same? Nope. Second window. 0.675. Second graph. Are y1 and y2 the same? Nope. Negative 7.1. Second graph. Are y1 and y2 the same? Nope. Second window. 2.5. Second graph. Y1 and Y2 the same? Yes, they are. All right, so we got 2.5 as our answer because Y1 and Y2 were the same. Okay, and so once again, that second window function is a great way for you to figure out your answer. All you got to do is hit second window, type in the answer choice, okay, and then go back to the graph, okay, and see your answer. The only thing I caution you with is notice how now your graph starts here, okay, at 2.5. If you want to go back to 0, for example, to go to the next problem, then you would have to go second window and just type in 0 again, okay, and that'll take you back to normal. Okay, and so now you're ready to do 6C and 6A on your own. And 6D as well. We're going to move forward now to number 12. All right, so number 12 says, a beach in Galveston recorded the number of visitors based on the average daily temperature. The data is shown below. Okay. First thing I would notice here is that it looks like I have a positive correlation. Okay, so it looks like my graph is moving in a positive direction. Okay, so that's one thing you should notice. If this trend continues, which of the following is the best prediction of the number of visitors to the beach when the average daily temperature is 90 degrees Fahrenheit? Okay, so I've got the temperature here in Fahrenheit, and I see right here is 90 degrees. Okay, and so what you're going to do is pretty much you're going to draw a trend line like I just did. Okay, and your trend line, you want to make sure there's roughly an even number of points above it as there are below it. Okay, and so I'm just going to draw a line up to here. Okay, until I kind of meet my line. And once I meet my line, I'm just going to draw a line over here so I can see the number of visitors. Okay, now remember, this is a prediction. Okay, so you're not going to be exact. Really, you're just going to find the answer choice that's closest to where your line is. Okay, and so right now I'm kind of in between 375 and 450, so I'm roughly maybe at 400. Okay, if you look at your answer choices, though, we see 375. And that's going to be the closest thing to where I drew my line, right? Because a trend line is a prediction. It's not exact. I could have drawn it like this, okay? And it could have gone right here, and it could have gone straight to 375, okay? But that's how you do predictions and trend lines, is you draw an estimation, okay, of a line going through the data. You want to make sure about half the points are below it, as there are above it. See, I have 6 above my line and 5 below my line. Okay, that's pretty good. Doesn't have to be exact. Okay, remember it's a prediction. Okay, this is the only time in math where you will really have to guess or predict. Okay, but it is a good prediction because you're actually following the trend of the data. The trend of the data is as the temperature goes up, the number of visitors goes up. Okay, it has a positive correlation. All right, and it looks like here on number 12, we have another positive correlation. Okay, and so this one I might start here, and I might draw it like this. Okay, remember you want about half the points above it as you do below it. Okay, so the teacher conducted a survey and asked his students how many hours they studied. For the last test they took, he compared the number of hours to each student's test score. The results of the survey are shown below. Which of the following is a good prediction of a test score for a student who studied 32 hours? Okay, so here I've got there's about 32 hours. Okay, and so I'm just going to go up. Okay, and so if I go over here, it's probably pretty close to 100. Okay, so on this one, this is a tough one. You know, it could be 95, it could be 100. I'm going to say that it's closer to 100. But then again, you know, you could have drawn a trend line that was a little more this way. Okay, and it could have been 95. Okay, usually your answer choices won't be that close together. But in this case, they kind of are. But looking at the trend, you know, it is a positive trend. It is going up. I did go to 32 hours. Okay, and I'm going to say, just because you probably could do this, I'm going to say it's probably 95, but it could be 100 on that one. You know, guessing in math, you know, nobody likes it. That's why we do math, so we don't have to guess. In some cases, you kind of do, like this one, especially when it's asking you to, what is a good prediction? Usually on your STAAR, though, your answer choices won't be this close together, okay? And so you'll be able to do it. I'm going to say it's 95. Just because of the way the line's going, it looks like there's a few more points here, so there'd probably be one here. But, you know, it very well could be 100. Once again, this is a prediction or an estimate. Okay, so I'm going to let you predict and do 12B on your own. And we're going to, in 12C, we're going to move to number 13. Number 13 is an easy one. What is the equation of the line graph below? Okay, you've got your equations here on your answer choices. Okay, so I'm just going to type them in. 1 divided by 4x plus 5. Go to the graph. Okay, well, I can see this has a positive slope, and right here I have a negative slope. If I make my n, so there's a negative slope. So any answer choice with a positive slope, I can cross out. That's A and that's D. So I don't have to worry about those anymore. Another great way to eliminate is look at your y-intercept. So I eliminated based on my slope. Now I can eliminate based on my y-intercept. Well, one's positive 5 and one's negative 5. My y-intercept is at positive 5. Okay, if it was at negative 5, that line would be down here. Okay, and you can tell the difference between the two when you type them in. Negative 1 divided by 4x plus 5. Okay, I can see that line looks the same as the one on my graph. If I had typed in the other one where this was minus 5, you could see the difference that it's way down there and goes through minus 5 instead of being up here going through plus 5. You can even type them both in and compare them if you really want to. See how the plus 5 is way up here at plus 5 and the minus 5 is way down here at minus 5. Same line, same slope. These lines would be parallel. They would never touch. The only difference is this one has a y-intercept of positive 5, y-intercept of negative 5. You're looking for positive 5 because that's what's on your graph. Okay, so 13A and 13B, I'm going to let you do on your own. We're going to come back to 14, simple and compound interest. Real quick, I want to skip to 15 because we're kind of on the same topic. All right, so 15 says a line has a slope of 3/4 and a y-intercept of 0, negative 4. This is probably the easiest, one of the easier questions on the STAAR test. I know we've already gone through some easy ones, but if your slope is 3/4, m is my slope, b is my y-intercept, so b would be negative 4. Okay, and so my equation is simply y equals 3/4 x minus 4. Okay, when it gives you slope and it gives you y-intercept, you just have to write the equation. Very, very easy. Okay, and that strategy is right there for you. Okay, they won't always be this easy. They won't always give you slope and y-intercept. They might give you slope and a point. They might give you the y-intercept and a point. They might just give you 2 points. Let's take a look and see what 15 and 16 do here. So see, this one gives you slope and y-intercept, so that one's easy. You should be able to do that one on your own. Actually, all three of them are giving you slope and y-intercept. So I'm going to let you do 15A and 15B on your own. You should be able to write those equations very simple, very easily. All right, now our last topic today and the last part of your STAAR World booklet is going to be simple and compound interest. After this, you have completed the STAAR World booklet. I will let you take them home today so you can study them over the weekend and watch the videos on my YouTube channel to prepare for your STAAR test. So here, Angelo has $5,000 to invest. His bank offers two options. Option A is simple interest at 3% for 4 years. Option B is compound interest at 3% for 4 years. If you remember, I taught you in class, when your interest rates are the same and your time is the same and your principal is the same, compound interest will always yield more money. Or you will earn more money, or vice versa, you will be charged more money, depending on whether you're borrowing or whether you're investing. In this case, you're investing, so you'll earn more money. But that's you can only really say that for sure, okay, when everything is the same. When your principal is the same, your interest rate is the same, and your time is the same, then you know compound will yield more. If the time and the interest rate are different and the investment is different, then you're going to have to calculate simple and compound separately to see which one would yield more. Okay? But it says, which of the following statements is not true about the two options? Okay, option A pays $27.54 less. Okay, so it looks like we're going to need to solve these. Okay, if they just asked you which one would yield more, you would know compound interest would yield more. So we're going to have to actually solve these. So we're going to do simple interest first. Okay, so simple interest is I equals PRT. You can find this formula on your STAAR reference material page. Okay, so I'm going to say my interest equals my principal, which is 5,000, times my rate. Okay, my interest rate is 3%. 3% as a decimal is going to be 3 divided by 100. So that's 0.03. Times the time in years, which is 4. So I'm going to come with my calculator. I'm going to do 5,000 times 0.03 times 4. And I get 600. So my interest is $600. Okay? So if I wanted the total in my bank account, I would have to take the principal, what I originally put in, and add my interest that I earned. And so A, or my total in the bank account, would be 5,600. Okay, I'm just going to write total in bank account. And this is the interest earned. Okay, so there's option A, so I can put option A. Okay, and now I'm going to do option B. Okay, option B is going to be compound interest. My formula is A equals P parentheses 1 plus R to the T power. Okay, so I'm going to say A equals my principal of 5,000 parentheses 1 plus 0.03 to the fourth power. Okay, literally taking the same numbers here. For P, R, and T, I'm just putting them in the different spots. For P, for R, and for T. Okay? Calculator time. 5,000, parentheses 1, plus 0.03. And then I use my little arrow here to the fourth power. All right, so I get A, which is the total in the bank account, is going to be $5,627, and we're going to round to 54 cents. Okay, and so if I wanted, so this is the total in the bank account, if I wanted the interest like I have up here, okay, then I would subtract the principal of $5,000, and so my interest would equal $627.54. So this is total in bank account, and this is the principal, so you're subtracting the principal, and this is the interest earned. Okay, and so it's really important that you know the difference between these two formulas. There's some big differences, obviously, in the way that you solve them. Okay, also in the answer that you get. For simple interest, you get the interest. Okay? And so if you want to figure out the total in the account, you have to add the principal to get the total in the account. Compound interest, you get the total in the account. If you want the interest, you have to subtract the principal to see the interest that you earned. Okay, so they're kind of backwards from each other, if that makes sense. Okay, so let's take a look at our answer choices. Option A pays $27.54 less interest over 4 years. So if I look at the interest, option A pays $600. Option B pays $627.54. So if I look at option B, $627.54 minus $600, that looks like that's definitely true. Option A pays $27.54 less over 4 years than option B. It's definitely true. Okay, but it says here, which of the following statements is not true? which of the following statements is not true? So option A is true, so we're crossing that out. Option B pays $5,027.54 more interest over the 4 years. Well, we know that's not true because we know it only pays $27.54. Okay, well, that's option A. But option B definitely does not pay $5,000 more. Okay, it actually pays $27.54 less. So that one is not true. Option B is the better option for Angelo, definitely, because he makes more money. Okay, we see he makes $27 more. Option A results in a total of $5,600 for Angelo. That's definitely correct. $5,600 is the total for option A. Okay? So B there was your answer. All right, I'm going to try to let you do the rest on your own. Okay, remember to use your formulas. Okay, you can refer to number 14 to make sure that you're doing the formulas correctly, that you're inputting everything correctly, and that you're doing your interest rate correctly. On these problems, just take your time. Make sure you enter things in the calculator correctly. Okay, make sure you understand when you're doing simple interest, the answer you get is the interest. Okay, and when you're doing compound interest, the answer you're getting is the total in the bank account. Okay, and so you've got to finagle those different ways to figure out the answer and what the question is asking you. Okay, you got to really pay attention to what the question is asking you. Okay? This is all I have for today. The rest of the problems that you didn't get to finish, that I didn't do, you're going to finish on your own for the remainder of the class period. You have this video now and all the other videos on the YouTube channel to be able to go home this weekend, review this entire STAAR booklet, and be ready to rock and roll on Monday. Good luck on your STAAR test, dudes. Proud of you. Make it happen.